Hello, testing. Get my audio going. There it is. Folks, this is James LaBrance. Before I get into my message, which is going to be one on end times Bible prophecy, in other words, eschatology, as it would be called theologically, before I get into it, I want to ask you to please, please fervently pray for those who are in Florida that have the Category 5 hurricane heading their way, and that will very likely cause loss of life, loss of people's lands, homes, properties, and it's a very sad thing. My wife and I have been praying for these people for days leading up to this hurricane that will make landfall very soon. While I'm talking on this video, it's very soon after. That's why I hope to get this published today, the same day I'm making it. But please pray for them. We've been praying fervently, and especially for those that we know who live there. Okay, and we just hope that there will not be any more damage than God will permit to happen. Okay, so thank you so very much for praying for them, and especially for the lives of people, that they will be spared, protected. And I thank you for doing that in Jesus' name. So God bless you, and I'm going to go ahead and get into my message now. I'll just start in with my notes here. There's a far worse time than what we see occurring now that's coming to the earth, the entire earth, that Jesus called the Great Tribulation period. He does differentiate that time from what he calls the beginnings of sorrows, which we're in right now. We're not in the Great Tribulation. We're in the times of worsening sorrows that will turn into Great Tribulation at the time that God's timing will allow it to happen. And so we do need to be prepared. And the main thing is to receive Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior by believing in his death on the cross, shedding his blood for the remission of our sins. On the way to the cross, he was beaten, bloodied, and then he was bloodied on the cross and he died there. Losing his blood profusely because he was nailed there by his hands and feet. He had a crown of thorns placed on his head that were embedded into his head and caused him much bleeding, as well as all those lashings he took that the Bible says lashed open his body. By his stripes we are healed, is what one scripture says. So Jesus went through terrible suffering and died there, but was placed in a tomb, and he was raised from the dead 3 days later, so that we could be saved if we would just receive that sacrifice he made for us. He took our place, the punishment we should have taken, and he took all of it for the whole world on the cross. You can imagine the agony. Some people think that that was just a physical agony. There was a horrendous agony on Jesus. In fact, before he was taken to the cross by the Roman soldiers, he was praying in Gethsemane, the Garden of Gethsemane. And as they were approaching, he knew when they were going to arrive, but he was praying. And it says that his sweat became as great drops of blood. And he even prayed, God, if this cup can pass from me, I pray that it could. But not my will, but yours be done. Now, Jesus also told his disciples, no one takes my life from me, I lay it down freely. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus, for that. Now, this time coming of great tribulation, while in the meantime, people are getting saved and becoming part of the church, the true church in Jesus Christ, Jews and Gentiles alike are being saved. Before this time happens, which is called in the book of Daniel, the 70th week of Daniel, because there were 70 weeks of years, in other words, 7 year increments of trouble for Jacob, the time of Jacob's trouble. Jacob is the man who became Israel. God renamed him. So the time of Israel's trouble. And it's going to get worse, and it's going to get very, very severe. Why then does it also include Gentiles? which I've already kind of said why, but because we can become part of the body of Christ through accepting Him as our Lord and Savior. And it's called the body of Christ. We're about the body of Christ and members in particular, because we were engrafted into the main tree, Israel, the olive tree. And the Apostle Paul says we were placed into that tree, into his body of believers. We were sealed into the body of Christ by the Holy Ghost. Praise God. Now, these branches that he talks about, here's a passage of scripture from Romans 11, verse 17 through 24, in which he talks about this being engrafted into the main tree, the real tree, the one that is the olive tree, Israel. And it says, "And if some of the branches be broken off, and thou, being a wild olive tree, were grafted in among them, and with them partake of the root and fatness of the olive tree, boast not against the branches. But if thou boast, thou bearest not the root, but the root thee. The root bearest thee. Thou wilt say then, the branches were broken off that I might be grafted in. Well, because of unbelief." Now this is what it actually says. "Well, because of unbelief they were broken off, and thou standest by faith. Be not high-minded, but fear. For if God spared not the natural branches, take heed lest he also spare not thee. Be not high-minded, but fear. For if God spared not the natural branches, take heed that he also spare not thee. Behold therefore the goodness and severity of God on them which fell. Severity on them which fell, but toward thee goodness if thou continue in his goodness. Otherwise thou shalt be cut off. And they also, if they abide not in belief, if they abide not still in unbelief, shall be grafted in, for God is able to graft them in again." Praise God. "For if thou were cut out of the olive tree, which is wild by nature, and were grafted contrary to the tree, contrary to nature, into a good olive tree, how much more shall these, which be the natural branches, be grafted into their own olive tree?" Jews into the believers who are Israel, the Jewish people, the Israelites. But we are Gentiles. However, here's what Paul said in regard to salvation in Jesus Christ. Galatians 3, 28 and 29. There is neither Jew nor Greek. There is neither bond nor free. There is neither male nor female, for ye are all one in Christ Jesus. And if ye be Christ's, then are ye Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. Heirs according to what promise? God said, "I will give you people that will be innumerable." Those who follow after your example of belief. Because Abraham believed and it was accounted unto him as righteousness. If we believe in Jesus Christ today, who is the true seed of Abraham, we shall be saved and we shall be engrafted into the tree, really the body of Christ, which is Jews, Gentiles alike. Okay, now Galatians. I just read that. Let me just say that one of the promises of God to God's people is that they will not suffer or undergo in any way the coming wrath of God that will fall upon the entire earth in the near future. How do I know that this great judgment of wrath is coming very soon? Because Jesus lists what he calls the beginnings of sorrows. Okay, that's not the great tribulation, that 7 years that is the last of the 70 weeks of Daniel. The 7 years determined upon God's people. 7 years of tribulation, of sorrow. The time of Jacob's trouble, it's even called. So Jesus lists what the beginnings of sorrows are, and then what immediately follows, which is called the Great Tribulation, God's mighty and terrible wrath. Let me read Matthew chapter 24, verse 5 through 14, that passage. Then I'm going to skip down to verse 21 and 22. Why am I skipping some of that in between? Only because it would take a whole another teaching. It would take a dissertation all by itself to teach you what it means about these people who flee, and they flee from God's wrath is what it is. That's what it is. And because they are, in essence, they are left behind. Okay, and so are Gentile people. And they will all wonder and be absolutely traumatized by what's going on. No doubt about it. Okay, the disciples asked Jesus, what shall be the sign of the end of time and of your coming back, when you come back? Jesus said, for many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. And you shall hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that ye be not troubled, for all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. For nation shall rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom, and there shall be famines and pestilences and earthquakes in diverse places. All these are the beginning of sorrows. Then they shall deliver you up to be afflicted, and shall kill you, and ye shall be hated of all nations for my name's sake. What are we seeing happening to Israel right now? Are nations gathering against them? Oh my goodness. How clear can that be? Just watch one night of the nightly news, world news, and you'll see it. But there's also people who are being taken hostage that are Jews. They are being slaughtered. They're being killed. Also, just innocent people being killed because of the warring that's going on right now. There are many, many people, thousands and thousands of people, have died already on both sides of this war. And it has not gotten better, but it has gotten worse. Said that you shall be afflicted and killed, hated of all nations. Then shall many be offended and shall betray one another and hate one another. Many offended. Have you seen the protests and things from any side, both sides, all sides? Yes, people are hating each other over this. Hey, you don't believe what our side does? We hate you, and if we could, we'd kill you. You blankety blank. Okay. And many false prophets shall arise and shall deceive many. And because iniquity shall abound, great sin shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold. Now, there's been a false prophet that arose in Israel itself, and there are many, actually. There's more than we think of that, even here in the United States. But in Israel, there was a rabbi. And it wasn't all that long ago, just a few months ago, maybe a year at the most. And they said that he was actually performing miracles and things. And many people believed he's the Christ. He is the awaited Christ, because they don't believe Jesus was the Christ, the Messiah. No, because he didn't restore the kingdoms back to Israel, where Jesus will reign from, where the Messiah will. They don't believe Jesus was the Messiah because he didn't restore the kingdoms to Israel. Okay, so that will be the capital of the world when Jesus returns. Make no mistake about it. Whether you like it or don't like it, or you're indifferent, it doesn't matter. It's still going to happen. He said many shall, you know, hate each other and stuff, and their love will wax cold against each other like a melted candle that hardens, and it continues to harden. No warmth to it ever anymore. It's cold. But he that shall endure unto the end, the same shall be saved. Now, do Christians have to endure to the end? Well, in a roundabout way, if you want to put it that way, we do go through persecutions and things. But folks, what the Jewish people are going through and will go through is so much greater than the type of thing that we go through, because we're upset about what we see in the rest of the world, is nothing in comparison. When it says the same shall be saved that endures to the end, that is talking to the Jewish people who have not received Jesus as Lord and Savior, but they have rejected him, and they are left behind. Now, some people would disagree with this. That's okay. Eschatology has room for lots of disagreements. Are they all horrible and bad, and the one that believes the wrong way is going to hell and so forth? I don't believe that. I think it's far too complicated. While some theologians may still say, oh no, it's very easy, and things like that. Well, I don't happen to agree with that. But these are people that will have to endure to the end. The same shall be saved. Now, if they're saved before that and they receive Jesus Christ, they are saved. They don't have to endure to any end of anything. They just wait. They await the coming, the great hope of Jesus Christ's return. Okay, and we all hope for that very soon, that are in Christ, that are born again in him. Hallelujah. The great hope. And the day of the Lord will be the day of God's wrath coming. And some people will have to flee to the mountains and hide and so forth. And it says the gospel of the kingdom, that's Jesus, the true kingdom of God, the true church, shall be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations, and then shall the end come. Okay, there's not only 144,000 Jewish people that are sealed by God in a special supernatural way. They cannot be harmed by anyone. They will be like evangelists that cover the world, and God will protect them. And nothing can befall them that would be of violence or death or anything like that. So they will be evangelizing of Jesus Christ, evangelists of Jesus Christ. And there's also a great angel at one point the Bible talks about in the book of Revelation during the Great Tribulation, and he will fly through the heavens proclaiming the gospel of Jesus Christ. Wow. Okay, that's going to be absolutely amazing, but I won't be here. Well, I won't be here to see it unless I am looking for where God is and he allows us to see this, because we will have been raptured. The Christian resurrection will happen before the Great Tribulation, and there's proof for that. I'm going to mention it to you here in just a little bit. Lots of proof for it. When ye therefore shall see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet standing in the holy place, whoso readeth, let him understand. Now I'm going to stop there. Who is this abomination of desolation? It is the Antichrist. The Bible says that he shall enter the temple of God, proclaiming he is God, showing that he is God, and that is the abomination of desolation, because he will not be God. He will be the messenger of Satan, the messenger of Satan, okay? The Antichrist, the false prophet. These others are just plural false prophets, false teachers, false Christs, and things like this. He will be the real deal, and he'll deceive the world. As many as will be deceived by him, he will deceive them. And he'll be standing in the temple of God proclaiming he's God, and that's what it's talking about. When you see the abomination of desolation, an abomination, an abominable thing entering the temple of God and saying they are God, they are the Messiah. Okay, and then I skip part of this because it talks about at that time people will flee. They will try to hide, because they know the wrath of God is falling. They will catch on to it at a certain point. And in my opinion, there are saints that will be tribulation saints, but most will die. They'll receive Christ. The true church is up there with Jesus in heaven. But those who become martyrs because of their testimony of Jesus Christ, the Bible says that they are found in heaven. There's scripture in the book of Revelation. I can't go into all that. As I say, some things are just a little too lengthy of a dissertation to make. So let me just continue with this. For then shall be great tribulation, as was not since the beginning of the world to this time, no, nor ever shall be. And except those days should be shortened, there should no flesh be saved, but for the elect's sake those days shall be shortened. So there's an elect number of Jews protected, and who evangelized during the Great Tribulation, and there's tribulation saints, as I said, people who get saved. Because who are they evangelizing? You know, the ones that are sealed and protected. They're evangelizing people, and some will be saved. They will be slain, or they will escape. And they will repopulate the earth when Jesus comes back. They will be here repopulating the earth, and to continue repopulating it through the thousand-year reign of Christ, called the millennial reign of Christ. Okay, that's actually going to happen, and we will be here with Christ when that happens. Afterward, the earth will actually be remade, the heaven and the earth, and there will be nothing but righteousness that dwells in it. Because Jesus will reign for a time of peace, because Satan will be bound for that 1,000 years when Jesus reigns. And so there will be peace even among the animal kingdom. The Bible describes this. You know, a wolf laying down with a lamb, and so forth. A child leading, you know, a lamb, a lion, a wolf, and so forth. So it's an amazing picture. It's very hard to fathom, but it will happen because of what we've always seen in our lives. There's violence everywhere, even in the animal kingdom, but it's all going to be peace and joy during Jesus' reign. But at the end of Jesus' reign, those who were really never for Jesus, but maybe pretended to be, will try to overthrow the kingdom of Jesus. That's when they're destroyed. God shall send fire from heaven and just destroy them totally. And then the Bible says that the earth itself will be destroyed by fire. In one of Peter's epistles, he said the earth shall burn with fervent heat and the elements shall melt. And so, wow, talking scientifically right there in the scriptures, the elements shall melt with fervent heat. So he said there would be this great tribulation. Some people ask the question, will the Antichrist show up before the church is taken out so that we actually see the arrival of him? Well, there's arguments about that, just like there is anything else. It's my belief that we won't even see the coming of that Antichrist. But, you know, God will work out his plan, and it will be great no matter what. Okay, Daniel 9:24, I don't believe I've read. 70 weeks are determined upon thy people. 70 weeks of years. The Great Tribulation period is the last 7 of those 70 weeks. 70 weeks are determined upon thy people and upon thy holy city to finish the transgression, to make an end of sins, and to make reconciliation for iniquity, and to bring in everlasting righteousness, and to seal up the vision and prophecy, and to anoint the Most High. So he's talking about Jesus right there. The Most High, to anoint the Most High, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, Jesus. Okay, now listen to what 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 10 says. Paul was writing to Christians. He said, and to wait for his Son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, even Jesus, which delivered us from the wrath to come. Okay, 1 Thessalonians, going on to a few chapters later, chapter 5, verse 9. For God hath not appointed us to wrath, but to obtain salvation by our Lord Jesus Christ. Okay, there's your two witnesses right there. Now, there's another one. 2 Thessalonians, the next book that Paul wrote to the church in Thessalonica, chapter 2, verse 6 through 11. Now, I'm referencing this chapter 2, verse 6 through 11 of 2 Thessalonians so that you can go and read it. It would take a lot more time than I want to take further with this teaching. But he talks about something that's withholding the arrival of the Antichrist until that thing is taken out of the way. Then shall that wicked be revealed, the Antichrist. And it says, only he who now withholds, now the word says letteth, but I have heard scholars of Greek and Aramaic, probably Hebrew too, anyway, they said the word letteth in this sense is a word that means allows, to allow. So, He who now allows will only allow until he, and it's talking about another he, until he be taken out of the way. Who's the he? It's the church of the living God, the body of Christ. The he is we who are in Christ, and we are members in particular, the Bible says, male, female, Jews, Greeks, Gentiles of all kinds, and we're all born again in Jesus Christ. When we're taken out of the way, because we're filled with the Holy Ghost, the Holy Ghost will still be here in his anointing and everything, but a lot of the restraining force, because Jesus said we're the salt of the earth, we're the light of the world. When we're removed, all havoc shall take place, right? That's obvious. That's really obvious. So we are the one withholding the arrival of the Antichrist. Now, folks, I can't cover very much. I can cover some like I just did in this type of teaching. But there's enough there to know that there's coming a time of wrath from God. But until then, we're living in the beginning of sorrows. I had to start from that. For these are the beginning of sorrows. Then Jesus said a little later down in that chapter 24 of Matthew, he said, for then shall be great tribulation, such as the world has never seen, no, nor ever shall again. The worst time of wrath, when Satan is allowed his reign of terror through the Antichrist system and other things he will do on the earth, he's allowed it, okay? But God, when his wrath comes on the earth, it's like nothing that Satan can do or that God has ever done before on this world. And like Jude said, that the Lord cometh with 10,000s of his saints. Behold, he said, as Enoch said, behold, Enoch said, the Lord cometh with 10,000s of his saints to execute judgment upon the ungodly. And then the word ungodly is used 3 or 4 times in that passage to make sure you know that this wrath is not for the godly, it's for the ungodly. Please remember that. Please know that there is an Antichrist coming. We don't know when. We're not absolutely sure that we won't be here as Christians, but boy, we sure won't be here long. If he arrives, off we go. But if we believe that scripture I just talked about, really, in reality, it's saying that we're withholding his arrival. And when we're removed, then the Antichrist shall appear. But folks, the main thing is, and I do believe what I just said, certainly, but the main thing is to remember that Jesus Christ is Lord. He loves you very, very much. He died for you on a cross, being crucified, placed in a tomb, and raised from the dead 3 days later, his resurrection. He loves you so much, and he is returning, and he's going to rule this world. But first, a time of God's wrath upon the ungodly. Look at all the ungodliness that has happened over thousands of years. God has built up wrath against that, and it's going to fall on the world very soon, in my opinion, very soon. Stay ready. The main thing, way to stay ready is to receive Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. Thank you so very much for listening to me. I want to mention, too, I did have a little bit of noise. I had a fan running here this time because it's very hot here, humid, and so forth. So anyway, thank you very much for listening to me. God bless you, and I will talk to you again soon. This is James Lawrence saying goodbye for now.